Hi, everybody. It's Tuesday. Welcome to the Q&A with the family support team at the St. Louis ARC. And today we have a hidden profession to share with you. We're going to talk to some child life specialists from Ranken Jordan. And I just want to say Ranken Jordan has always been such a wonderful partner with the ARC. Back in the day, we used to do our sip shops at the Ranken Jordan building. So I have a very soft place in my heart for Ranken. And I'm really happy that we can have you joining us today. So without further ado, I'm going to introduce our guests and let them tell you a little bit about themselves. Hi, Megan and Katie. Thanks for joining us. Who would like to start?
I can start us off. Thank you, Sharon. My name's Katie.
And I'm Megan.
And we are both child life specialists at Ranken Jordan Pediatric Bridge Hospital. Ranken Jordan is a 60-bed rehabilitation hospital located in Maryland Heights. We are a facility where the kid is maybe not, no longer needs to be at the big hospital anymore, but they're not quite ready to go home. So this is kind of their in-between place where they're in therapy most of the day and we're securing a safe discharge to home or whatever that home may be. With that being said, we are just going to get right into it and talk a little bit about the child life profession. You might find child life specialists anywhere where there's potential for stress in children, where there's potential for poor coping. We like to use our understanding of childhood development to help kids tackle these stressful situations. We do this through preparation, through age-appropriate information. We do this through play. And we also do this by kind of working with the whole family, siblings, caregivers, and see what their understanding is as a family unit and trying to help give them tools to promote coping for everyone. So yeah, a little bit about our education. We do require at least a bachelor degree. Some people have masters, this one over here. A 600-hour internship is required in order to become a certified child life specialist, as is the sitting and passing of a child life certification exam. This is a quote from the AAP that we really like. Without the assistance of a professional who understands their unique perspective, children of all ages may experience emotions such as fear, shame, confusion, loneliness, which can inhibit their natural development and have lasting negative effects on their well-being. Child life specialists are trained with the expertise in helping children and families overcome life's most challenging events. So maybe that challenging event is a hospitalization, a new diagnosis, maybe it's a death. It can look a lot of different ways, and we feel confident and equipped to help them navigate that stressful time.
So children who are hospitalized are at risk to different negative effects of the hospitalization, and it's common to see different age-specific reactions. So some things that you might see if you have an infant or toddler who is being hospitalized, that loss of routine that they have at home, a lot of times separation from caregivers if they aren't able to stay at bedside, sensory overload, so many different noises, sounds, smells, different things that they're seeing, and then painful procedures. For the preschool population, that separation anxiety again, and then there's a lot of misconceptions with the hospital and the medical procedure. They might not understand the medical jargon that we so often use. A loss of control, they're not able to often get up and walk around. They might be connected to a pole, to receive medications. And in this age group, we also see a lot of regression. Maybe if your child was potty trained prior to their hospitalization, we might start seeing bedwetting again, more tantrums, those types of behaviors. In our school age population, you know, six to about that 10, 11, 12 age, that's still the loss of control, change in routine, separation from family, and now their peers that they've been meeting through school, and a loss of independence. A lot of things that they were previously maybe doing independently, toileting, walking in some cases, some of those things, they need more adult help again. And lastly, our adolescents. lack of privacy, which can be expected in the hospital setting, loss of independence, the separation from peers and family. Oftentimes we'll see altered body image issues and just concerns for the future and how this hospitalization and maybe their new diagnosis is going to affect them in the future.
And one thing we want to mention is that no hospitalization looks the same on everyone. Like a lot of times you may have two kids around the same age with similar situations, and they may have two very different reactions, and that's okay. There's a lot of things that, you know, come into play, such as their temperament, the availability of family support. You know, is this their first time at the hospital or with this procedure, or have they been in and out of the hospital their whole life? So there's a lot of things that kind of go into it. Oftentimes caregivers are like, oh my gosh, I can't believe my child's reacting this way. And our job is to validate that and say, you know what, this is tough. You know, they used to be, you know, 2 weeks ago, they were at school with their peers and now they're hooked up to an IV and, you know, they don't know when they're going to go back to school. So we do a lot of validating and ways to kind of restore a sense of control when oftentimes it feels very out of control.
Yeah, I can totally see that. You talked earlier about age-appropriate prep. I don't know if that's something you'll talk about later on as we go, but I'm curious, as you look at those different life stages, what are some of the ways that you would talk to a child about an upcoming procedure?
For oftentimes procedures that are planned in advance, for that preschool, older toddler population, we recommend prep right before the procedure or the night before, maybe if you're going to like a same day surgery. At school age and adolescent procedure, we would recommend starting those conversations at home a little bit earlier. A week or so in advance is usually a good amount of time. We always tell parents that they know their child best, however, but these are our just general guidelines. For the preschool population, we love to use bibliotherapy through books,
dolls,
medical dolls, medical supplies, letting them act out what they think might be happening and being able to clarify misconceptions through there. Also just presenting them with a lot of sensory stimulation of things that they might experience during the procedure. A lot of those techniques are also really good for the school age population, adolescent population as well, but they're able to give a little bit more feedback of what they think will be helpful to them.
You know, we have so many families that communicate with us that particularly their older children or adolescent children, that they have been to hospitals with them many, many times over the course of their lives, and that they don't feel like the medical professionals really listen to what the family's experience is, especially if the child doesn't have a typical way of communicating. And I wondered if you guys ever bridge those kind of situations where maybe mom knows quite a bit about history of how certain things, anesthesia impacts the child or the way they're communicating and what that might mean about pain, and yet the medical professionals aren't quite there.
Absolutely. I always tell parents that they are their child's biggest advocate. So I think in a pediatric hospital setting, I think always asking for, you can always request child life, whether they're available in the moment or not, they're usually able to put that referral in. And child life specialists are a great resource for bridging those gaps with the medical team.
Wow. I think also encouraging caregivers to have maybe a little notepad with the things that they find super important that they want to share with medical staff. I know sometimes it can be so intimidating and they have these things they want to say or questions they want to ask, but then maybe med staff gets in there and maybe they seem hurried and they don't feel like they can, you know, ask their questions. So just, you know, from the get-go, just saying, hey, these are some important facts I really want you to know. And again, just being that advocate and not being afraid to use their voice, because they do know their child best. And ultimately, it's going to help the provider.
Yeah, we'll encourage families even to create something with some pictures of the child at baseline so that they can see on a typical day, this is how this child responds, this is how these things are happening, because so often there's a disconnect with that.
Absolutely. And I think doing anything that you can ahead of time, so in the moment you do not forget any of that important information that you'd like to relay to the medical team, is fantastic.
kind of makes me think of something we're trialing, which is making individualized coping plans for patients when they have a consistent procedure, whether that's every other day or once a week. Just kind of some tangible tips and tricks, whether it's positioning or things that help them calm during or afterwards, that we can share with staff who are going to be involved so that everybody is on the same page, knowing what helps, what to steer clear of. So that too might be something a caregiver can kind of whip up, some document that just says, hey, you know, this is how they usually react to this. This is what helps. Please, you know, steer clear of this if you can.
So just very briefly, the role of a child life specialist is to promote positive coping and emotional safety during stressful events. Interventions often promote positive coping, include therapeutic play, opportunities for normalization within the hospital setting, open and age appropriate communication with patients and their families, and just promoting that sense of control and restoring it to the child as appropriate throughout their stay. And then emotional safety is something that the child life field is very focused on, but it's just defined as an intentional practice to promote resiliency, healing, and trust for pediatric patients and their families.
To piggyback on kind of back to age-appropriate communication preparation, one thing that we work hard to do as child life specialists is use soft language. So maybe instead of, oh, this is going to burn when you get this medication, like, oh, you might feel a warm feeling. Or instead of, you know, they're going to make an incision as big as, you know, a piece of Play-Doh, you can say, oh, it's going to be smaller than this. So just kind of being very mindful of our language, still being honest, but just being mindful of how some words sound. And actually, I think we have a slide dedicated to that later, kind of what the word is, what it sounds like, especially to those concrete thinkers. So we like to consider play to be the work of the child. Play is a universal language. It's a quick way to build rapport with a child, to, you know, be your true authentic self. We love play in the hospital. It promotes wellness. We know that the link between mind and body is so, so real. And we know that play helps heal just as much as medication does. Oftentimes during a hospitalization, especially a lengthy one, kids may be behind in development or regress, and play is a way to make sure they stay on track with those developmental milestones.
So oftentimes I think medical team members will come in and they'll see us playing with a child, and it's very fun, and, you know, we're getting the child up and moving, but we're also, you know, trying to build trust with that child. So when there is a difficult procedure or difficult conversation that needs to be had, we can be that trusting person for the child and communicate with the team.
Another type of play that we implement is medical play. And this is when children are given the opportunity to play with and explore and manipulate actual and pretend medical equipment in order to promote a sense of mastery and control. It's role reversal in a sense where they're the doctor or they're the nurse, or maybe in their play, they want to be the patient. But it's a great way to promote control. It's a great tool to see what they understand. You can use it as an opportunity to clarify any misconceptions they may have. Maybe you notice that they're saying, I did something bad and now I'm in the hospital. And we can say, oh, actually, you know, people go to the hospital because maybe something in their body is sick. No one goes to the hospital because they did something wrong. And I think the big takeaway with this is giving them a sense of control, where oftentimes they don't get a lot of control at the hospital. So this is one way where they can be in control.
So preparation for medical procedures and treatments. As we know, for adults also, surgery and medical experiences can be very stressful. So our role is to really promote understanding at an age-appropriate level and giving them those words to utilize and communicate how they're feeling. Like we said, we use lots of books, teaching dolls, and this can help a child know what to expect during a procedure, which has been shown to reduce emotional disturbance and promotes a sense of control.
We believe that the fear of the unknown is greater than the known. And especially with all the TVs and videos that kids see these days, it's easy for them to think something is way scarier than it is, or just it's easy for them to stumble upon something and think that's the reality when maybe it's not. So, you know.
Especially with the school age and adolescent children, they have access to the internet at their fingertips. So just really helping to clarify anything that they may have overheard a doctor saying to a parent or a family member talking about, really making sure that they have the facts.
I feel like there's been so much trauma around like being in the hospital with the current pandemic. And I wonder if you all have had to incorporate some therapeutic play or social stories or other kinds of things around COVID protocols to help people understand what some of those things are about.
Absolutely. I think even in terms of for a while during the COVID-19 pandemic, we were not able to have our full visitor policies enforced. So they were maybe only allowed to have one or two designated people with them at a time, usually a parent. But
so
trying
stressful.
To have them very stressful. You know, they're not seeing their siblings or their grandparents or that close friend that maybe is a really good support system to them, and helping them understand that it's nothing that they did. We're just trying to keep everyone safe and healthy. You know, we're not trying to be mean. Some of those are misconceptions that those younger children have, especially.
Yeah. And, you know, during that time, we were able to get creative and facilitate weekly virtual calls and interactions with people who maybe weren't able to visit. So, you know, we tried our best to maintain that connection, but yeah, it definitely felt different not being able to have as many people in the building.
Yeah, I can remember back in the beginning, even explaining why people looked weird with masks on was part of a kind of a new routine for us.
Uh-huh.
Lots of coaching for parents also on how to talk to their children about these topics in the news, such as like wearing masks and the transmission of COVID-19, giving them good pointers of what's good information to share, what's not good information to share, how can you promote positive coping, even for their children at home.
Yeah, I want to talk just briefly about that, because I think families sometimes are so anxious and stressed during a time of a medical procedure, and that emotion transfers to the child and they sense all of that. And you kind of talked briefly about kind of helping the family sort through some strategies to work with their child. What is your role with families, with parents, with siblings, with other important members of the family? How are you engaging with them?
So we're very involved with families. In terms of a procedure, we can start with that. We would be coaching a parent if they would like to be in the room. Sometimes for families and caregivers, it is just too much for them to see their child in pain. And that's okay. We encourage that as well, because like you said, the child does pick up on their parents' anxiety and fear. But if they do choose to stay in the procedure, we can coach them through the whole thing, showing them different ways they can maybe hold their child, different ways they can help distract their child throughout the procedure, where they should stand while their child is getting this IV placed. So kind of giving them concrete jobs and how they can be involved is usually helpful to parents. In the hospital setting, especially in the inpatient world, we offer a lot of support to caregivers and siblings. Siblings in terms of helping them understand why their child's in the hospital, or siblings in the hospital, giving them some positive attention, because oftentimes the hospitalized child is getting all the attention, getting presents, and it can be difficult for them to understand. You'll see a little bit of jealousy sometimes, but also anxiety and just acting up at school are really common things we see with siblings. Mm-hmm. And also just kind of coaching parents on how to provide support to those siblings at home. In terms of caregiver support, a lot of validation and listening, active listening to their concerns, helping them connect with peer caregivers who might be going through a similar thing through support groups, community organizations, and really providing them with coping skills as well and coping tools so that they can be at their best to provide the best care to their child.
We push a lot of self-care, you know, offer caregivers breaks and try to remind them as often as we can that, you know, in order to take care of their child, they need to make sure they're taking care of themselves. So, you know, lots
okay, I'm sorry, but now that I have to give a shameless plug. So just as a reminder to our families that access the ARCH respite services, if you have a situation arise that's unusual, if you have a child in the hospital, if you have a situation where something's changed in your home life, you can just pick up the phone and then call us. And if we have the hours, we'll increase the number of hours you're authorized so that you can get a break. You could have somebody else come into the hospital setting and stay with your child. You can stay in the hospital, but go somewhere and take a nap. And as long as you're getting a breather, those are acceptable ways to use respite. So I appreciate your talking about that part for families, because if you're going to stay the course, you do need to take care of yourself at the same time.
Yeah, what a great Absolutely. Service. That's awesome.
So getting a little bit into procedural support, child life specialists help coach the child and the parents throughout the procedure. So we are in that procedure room with the child, with the caregiver, using supportive language, utilizing positions for comfort, and offering diversional activities. So some diversional activities might include, you know, watching a favorite video, deep breathing, VR goggles, engaging in a game of I Spy, holding a fidget in their hands and blowing bubbles.
Some kids even prefer to watch. I mean, we have lots of kids, especially school agers, who get more anxious when we're trying to distract them and they know what we're doing. And we, you know, try to educate staff, like, that's okay. That's their way of coping. With that being said, crying is also a very appropriate coping skill. I know it can be hard and uncomfortable to sit there with someone when they're crying. You know, there's tears, they're in pain. But just letting them know it's okay to cry, you're doing your best. Those words are favored more over don't cry or I'm sorry. We're big into it's okay to cry, you're working hard.
I like that.
I'm not measuring success of a procedure based on if a child has cried or not. We like to measure success of the procedure of getting through it and maybe finding something that child did really well. You held your arm so still throughout the whole time so the nurse could do their job.
Yep. Yeah. You'd be surprised how many kids, the older ones, will be like, I cried, so I didn't do well. And we say, that's okay to cry. That hurt. You did great. You got through it. Mm-hmm. And another thing we look for is their return to baseline. So how quickly are they to return to play, to return to their typical personality? Those are the big indicators that we're looking at that show us how they're coping. All right. A note on pain management. Again, these are things that you can advocate for, whether you're in the hospital or maybe you're going to an outpatient procedure or maybe even just a general checkup at the doctor and you know they're getting vaccinations. There most likely won't be a child life specialist at the pediatrician's office, but they most likely have a numbing cream or something like that. Positioning for comfort. So those are just comfort holds where a caregiver or a child life specialist can help secure the child in a secure hold so that they don't have to be lying flat on their back during the procedure. We know that when a child is flat on their back, that feels very out of control, that feels scary. So any chance we can allow the child to sit upright while maintaining their safety and making sure we can still get the procedure done, we're going to advocate for a comfort hold. We might also advocate for a numbing cream. We have a numb spray we use, or Emla cream. Some creams have to sit on the skin for 20 minutes before it takes effect. Others are more fast acting. But, you know, a lot of kids tell us that they feel the poke less while using these creams. Obviously, you know, talk to your pediatrician before utilizing these things with your child. But, you know, if they give you the green light, these are things to look into. Buzzy Bee and Shop Blocker. These are things that you can actually purchase on your own. They kind of use the gateway theory of pain where it's going to be a vibrating sensation on the skin at the same time as the painful procedure. And it kind of tricks the brain to feel the vibration over the pain. Mm-hmm. So that's not to say they don't feel the pain completely, but kids will say that it felt less sharp.
Yes. And those can be just purchased through Amazon.
Nice. All right. Mm-hmm. I don't know what Sweet Ease is. I've been waiting for this one.
Yeah. You want to talk on that one?
So Sweet Ease is just, it's more for our infant population, but it's basically just an oral sucrose solution. So it's basically kind of a little bit of water mixed with sugar. This will often, so maybe just putting a little bit into a pacifier for an infant to suck on throughout the procedure, that sucrose kind of can increase their ability to tolerate pain. Another thing for infants that we recommend too is ask your doctor about maybe breastfeeding during an injection. That is okay, and that can help your child with their coping, or giving them a bottle immediately after. Those are things that help a lot with the infant populations.
Some additional strategies for your child: offering a warm or cold pack. Again, back to the diversional activity. So if your child has a favorite song or an absolute favorite cartoon, maybe something that's novel that you save just for, you know, times at the pediatrician, something like that. The power of affirmation. So maybe practicing some affirmations while you're in the car, like, I can do this. It's okay to be scared. I am strong. Things like this can really promote positive coping. We're big fans of deep breathing. You know, we're always encouraging parents and caregivers alike, you know, to take deep breaths and be mindful of that, and how there's a big connection, you know, taking deep breath signals your brain to let out chemicals that calm you down. There's science behind it. So we can't talk enough about deep breathing. And then lastly, guided imagery. So maybe encouraging the child to close their eyes, and maybe you're walking them through their favorite story. Maybe it's The Very Hungry Caterpillar, where you're saying, okay, you're the egg, and now you're the cocoon, and then you're the beautiful butterfly. You can kind of tailor it to your child or teen. And then these pictures are actual examples of different comfort holds.
Yeah, I was looking at those. That's so cool. And I never really thought about it, but it does feel so much nicer to be supported by somebody in a situation like that. So love it.
Oh my gosh. Yes, being on your back is incredibly scary.
Well, even just sitting up for a shot by yourself, you start to tense up because you're thinking about what's going to happen, I think.
So this is kind of looking at being mindful of the language we use when talking to kids about medical procedures or equipment. So an IV, some kids, you know, that kind of sounds like poison IV. That was an itchy kind of plan at my grandma's house. And so we might use language like, oh, an IV is actually a tiny bendy straw that's going to give your body a drink of water or some medicine. You know, thinking about, oh, you're going to get a shot. Some kids hear shot and think of a gun. So we might say, oh, you're going to get a poke. The poke is going to deliver some medicine to keep you healthy. Even saying things like put to sleep if they're getting a surgery, and, oh, well, you're going to get put to sleep. Well, the family dog got put to sleep and they didn't come back. So, you know, now the child has a fear of going to bed, or even worse, they think they're going to go to surgery and their body's going to stop working. So just being clear in our words and mindful, and just trying to be as age appropriate, simple and honest as we can. We even have ways to talk to kids about skin grafts. So when they use healthy skin to cover a part of their body that has been hurt, you know, we're able to kind of find the right words so that a patient can understand.
A few other child life priorities: diagnosis education. If a child has a new diagnosis, for example, if they have a new leukemia diagnosis, we might make blood soup and help them understand the different parts of the blood and the role of the cancer cells and why that's making them feel sick, talking about chemotherapy and how that's going to help fight off those cancer cells, but it might also, you know, fight off our hair cells as well as some of those healthy cells. So just kind of helping them understand in a more playful manner with terms that they are able to developmentally understand. Some school reentry for children who have been in the hospital for a long time or maybe look different than their peers might remember. Going into the classroom and helping educate teachers, school counselors, and peers on where the child has been, why they might look differently or have different abilities, and also ways to include them and maybe ways that they don't want help, things that they don't want to be asked when they return to school. We already touched on some family and sibling support and then bereavement support through legacy building and memory making. Unfortunately, children in the hospital setting often are fighting chronic and long-term battles, and we help families make tangible items to kind of remember their child for through and help them be involved with that as much as possible.
Gosh, I just think this has been so educational for me. My thoughts are that so many of the supports that you talked about are make complete sense and are actually really interesting to me to think about for some of our adult population that we struggle with having these appointments and folks that we work a lot with desensitization, preparing them for an appointment, but I don't think we do some of the things we can to make the actual visit more comfortable. And I love some of the ideas that you'd suggested. So awesome. Excellent.
Good. The next slide touches on some of our free community programs offered here at Ranken. Sorry, I just realized I never finished the first sentence. How often is virtual infant massage?
It is 6 times a year. Every other month, we will have a virtual infant massage training on a Saturday morning, typically. And we can kind of teach new parents how to help bond and comfort and their child.
Registration is required for all these things, but everything is free. Bridges Grief Support Group is a virtual grief support group for individuals grieving the death of someone in their life, regardless of when or how it happened. It's offered 3 times throughout the year. We meet once a week for 6 weeks. And then typically there's a follow-up group about a month after group 6. And there is a group for adults, a group for teenagers, and a group for kids. Giving them a chance to be around other people grieving a death, share their stories, try on some different coping skills. So that's one of our ongoing programs. And again, you can hop on our website under events and classes. I believe you can sign up for all these things, or you can reach out to us. Our information is on the next slide.
You want to talk about that? And then lastly, we do have a support group for caregivers of a child or teen with a traumatic brain injury. That program is offered in person at Ranken Jordan or via Zoom. And we meet monthly the 3rd Tuesday of the month from 6 to 7:30. Registration is also required for that one. On our website, it's a little bit different spot. It's under family support.
Yeah, feel free. This is our information. Anyone is welcome to reach out to us via phone, email with additional questions. If you want more information with our programs, or maybe you want to troubleshoot a situation involving a child and an upcoming medical event, feel free to reach out.
I think it was such important information. I'm really glad you shared some examples and really gave us a chance to think about the way we support a child throughout a medical situation in their life, from kind of thinking about it to going through a procedure to the recovery and returning to whatever the next step of life is going to look like. It's really nice to hear about the family support component. So thanks so much for being willing to come and talk with us today. I really appreciate it.